Hi. Today I'd like to share some thoughts on the topic of how to be a good comforter. We live in a world where there's a profound suffering among people who are experiencing a lot of anguish and pain and loneliness, depression, anxiety, people dealing with loss, tension in their relationships, and so forth. And I believe it's our responsibility as believers in Christ to help comfort and support people who are suffering. Now, when it comes to various physical needs people have, and we have the ability to meet those needs, whether it be food and clothing, certain financial needs, it is important for us to be willing to sacrifice to help people in those situations. But what I want to focus on in this teaching is when it comes to suffering that others might be going through, that we may not be able to alleviate that suffering in a direct, practical way, such as giving them money and food and shelter and so forth. In other words, I'm talking about situations where people are suffering due to things like maybe chronic health issues, loss of a loved one, and strained relationships, abuse, and so forth. Such stresses can inflict a lot of suffering on a person, even to the point that that person begins to shed tears in despair of life. But it's important to consider that even we can't fix their situation so that they are no longer stressed and no longer crying, there is a responsibility we have to help them. Responsibility that we have is to be empathetic to them and then actually enter into their suffering and be willing to suffer along with them. In connection to this idea, I want to draw your attention to Romans chapter 12, verses 15. We reread, "Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that weep." Now, one of the things that Paul does in Romans 12 is he lists some of the various responsibilities that believers have towards other believers. Particularly when it comes to verse 15, Paul mentions the responsibility believers have when it comes to the various emotional states that other believers may be experiencing. Namely, we are to seek to enter into that same emotional state that they are in. He first speaks of the need to rejoice with those that rejoice. Then we see that we are not only to enter into the joy of other rejoicing brethren, but we are to enter into their grief as well. For Paul says in verse 15, we are to weep with them that weep. Now, the word weep can refer to crying, but it can also carry the idea of lamenting, feeling sorrow. And sorrow is that unpleasant, troubling feeling inside that as a response to negative experiences, whether internal or external. And Paul indicates that one of the things that we are to do for such people experiencing sorrow is we are to experience sorrow as well. We are to weep with them. Now, of course, I don't think Paul has the idea of us simply grieving for another believer who's feeling sad, regardless of the cause of their sadness. Rather, Paul is calling us to have a sorrow that is an intelligent sorrow, where it is based on a degree of knowledge of why someone else is troubled in their heart and mind. Now, this brings me to my first point as to how we are to be a good comforter to people who are suffering. Namely, we are to be willing to listen to their pain. That is, we are to listen to the reasons why they are hurting or suffering if they are comfortable sharing. Of course, not only will this assist in us in understanding the cause of their grief, but the act of listening is actually something that can be therapeutic in alleviating some of the suffering of someone else. See, for people who are hurt and going through a hard time in life, often they want someone to listen to them. They want someone that they can confide in. And this is one of the main reasons why psychiatrists can be so popular today. Many times psychologists make great listeners. Even if they don't say much, they can often just ease the stress of their patients by just listening to them. See, people who are suffering can find some comfort from us if we just close our mouths and just patiently listen. Because this helps to show them that we value them, we care for them. It helps us to make them feel safe in our presence. We're just willing to just sit and listen to them, even when they may share things that can be a bit disturbing for us to hear. You may not be able to undo the damage that's done to them in any way, get them out of the trials they are in, but just by listening can help them cope and help siphon some of the pain out of their system as they process it by means of expressing it to you. To use an analogy, imagine if you're on a boat at sea and the boat gets damaged in some way and begins to take in water. which may result in the boat beginning to sink. Now, you might not be able to fix the boat, but what you can do, you can help get water out of the boat by bucketing the water out of the boat and help keep it from sinking. This is similar to the function of sympathy and being a good listener to those who are suffering. The person might have been hurt really badly, experienced some great loss or disappointment, and they can become like a boat at sea that has suffered damage and is beginning to take in water. And the person, in a sense, takes in water into their soul, where they begin to sink in depression, grief, fear, and anxiety. Now, you may not be able to undo any of the damage that was done to them, but you can help bucket some of the water of grief out of them. You can help lessen the pain, in a sense, help siphon it out of their system by being compassionate to them, comforting them, giving them a listening ear, just closing your mouth and listening. There's a saying that says, a joy that's shared is a joy made double, a sorrow that's shared is half the trouble. And indeed, when we allow people to weep before us and express and share the cause of their pain and trouble, it can actually help lessen the trouble and ease their pain. By the way, if you appreciate this video and you want to hear more videos on this topic, feel free to give this video a like. That helps to encourage me, and it can also help to give this message more exposure on YouTube. Now, having said that, I want to move on to the second point of this teaching in regard to comforting someone who is suffering. And this is an intimate connection to listening to someone's pain, and that is we must be sure to affirm the person's pain. See, studies have shown that unpleasant emotions, such as sadness and depression and anger, can actually be assuaged through affirmation, but they are generally aggravated through negation. Now, let me just reiterate that. This is so important. And when it comes to being a good comforter, negative emotions are assuaged through affirmation, but they are aggravated through negation. When I speak about negation, I'm referring to when we make light of a person's negative emotions. When we might say something like, don't feel so bad. You're overreacting. Cheer up. Get over it. Look at the bright side. There are people suffering far more than you. For the sanity of humanity, I highly suggest you never, ever do this when you're trying to comfort somebody. Okay, to give you a quick example of how foolish this is, imagine you smash your thumb in a car door, and you're in absolute agony, and you're groaning and crying, but assume I'm there, and I'm trying to comfort you. And let's say I'm like, hey, I'm sorry you're dealing with this, but please remember, there are many people out there that don't even have thumbs or fingers. They don't even have hands. Right. Just try to look at the bright side and count your blessings, that God has blessed you with hands and fingers, and don't be moaning and groaning about this pain in your thumb. Okay? How are you going to respond to that? Are you going to be like, oh, well, thank you very much. I feel so much better now. Thank you. No, I'm sure you wouldn't find that very helpful at all. You'll likely find that quite insensitive and infuriating. And why? Because I'm making light of your suffering. I'm speaking as though you don't have a right to express your intense pain. Now, this is just a simple example of why you must never make light of someone else's pain when they're suffering, when you're trying to comfort them. And it doesn't matter how strong a person thinks they are, how big and tough. No normal person likes it when their pain is belittled in any way. Right? One of the easiest ways to further inflame their suffering is to make light of it. This means you should refrain from judging that person's emotional state, where you basically end up, condemning them for feeling something too deeply, or you're basically telling them that their emotional state falls short of some standard as to what a normal emotional state is in a given situation. Instead, you need to just respect the sufferer and how they are feeling, and realizing they are unique, and they may simply handle their griefs in a different way, in a more deeper way than others do. So I like to say, the way a person feels at any given moment during the day, whether it be positive or negative, is sometimes the result of the cumulative effect of hundreds, thousands, or even millions of life experiences that they have had in their past, many of which you are completely oblivious to. And so you're not fit to judge them. You're not fit to judge their emotional state. Assume someone is feeling very depressed over some unkind remark that someone made to them. Let's say it's about their looks. Now, you might be someone who wouldn't be bothered as much if someone made such a remark to you about your looks. But the person you're trying to comfort is not you, and they most likely have had experiences in their past that you may have not had. Okay? You don't know if the hurtful remark they've heard could have triggered some painful, traumatic memories in their past, things they experienced when they were young, things that could be at the root of maybe their depression issues. Maybe they were severely bullied in school or abused in school. These may be experiences they're not comfortable sharing with you. But even if the remark didn't trigger any old memories, when a person is feeling hurt, they were disrespected in some way, and they're feeling down, you need to respect the way they feel. You may not always understand why they feel the way they do, but you can still respect it and affirm it. In connection to this, I would suggest you be extremely careful when giving advice to someone who is suffering. Remember that such a person can be in a very emotionally unstable, weakened state. So they'd be more sensitive and more easily provoked than normal. Imagine you take a hot dish out of the oven, and because you have mittens on, you're generally going to be able to handle holding that hot dish, so you're not going to burn your hand. Now imagine that you're carrying the dish and with the mittens on, that you're protecting your hands, and because maybe you're not thinking too much and you're being a little careless, and you're not mindful how hot the dish is, you carelessly hand the dish off to someone who doesn't have mittens on. And so they may end up grabbing the dish, and they get burned. Right? This is similar to how some people approach giving advice. At times, people cook up advice in their heads, and it's advice that they can handle in their own minds. It doesn't cause them any pain. They have mittens on, so to speak. Maybe they have never suffered intensely, never gotten rejected, and so forth. They don't know what it's like to be depressed or anxious. So they can end up being kind of out of touch with how their advice will, in a sense, burn those they're trying to help. So just picture them handing over the advice like a hot dish to somebody else who is already in a lot of pain. Because they don't have mittens on, so to speak, now they're forced to hold onto this advice in their head. This can result in them getting emotionally burned, or they get irritated and aggravated, maybe more depressed. Imagine telling some guy who just got his heart broken by a girl he's been dating for years. He's in tears and he's so depressed. And I come along and I'm like, hey, well, there's other fish in the sea, and just try to put yourself out there and maybe get on eHarmony. With such words, I basically handed him a burning hot emotional dish that may burn his brain, so to speak. Again, it's important to be very careful how you speak to someone who is suffering, right? You need to think before you speak. Be mindful of that great advice you've cooked up in your head might end up burning someone if you give it to them in a careless way. Maybe, before you hand off that hot dish of advice to somebody, you can work on letting it cool down a little, potentially, rewording it a little bit, maybe making it more affirming and less judgmental, less critical and insensitive. I also think it's important that to try to avoid telling people who experience something painful not to think about it. And this is like telling somebody we ate a big meal, don't digest the food. The fact is, the food's in the person's stomach, assuming their digestive system is normal, their body is going to digest it. Likewise, when someone experiences something painful, there's a strong emotional charge. Their brain needs to digest it and process it. And one of the ways the brain processes the experience is by dwelling on it for a time. It's the way the brain is designed. It can be painful, of course, when the brain does focus on the painful experience, but that pain is generally just a byproduct of the pain processing that disturbing experience where it's trying to learn everything it can from the experience. So we have seen that when it comes to being a comforter, we need to listen to the person's pain, affirm the person's pain, but finally, I'd like to focus on how we are to be willing to feel the person's pain. So when God tells us to weep with those who weep, and he's calling us to shed tears, he's not calling us to put on some kind of act or some kind of facade. He's speaking of literal tears, I believe. These are tears of sympathy, which are the result of truly feeling something of the pain of those you're trying to help. See, God wants us to get down on their level emotionally, as this can help the sufferer feel a degree of comfort. It's the saying, misery may love company, but what it seems to love more is compassion. See, when a sufferer sees you weeping with them, it can make them feel less alone, make them feel of more value to you. It assures them that someone else is willing to be there with them in their darkness. In addition, when we get down on their level emotionally, that can help us better understand their situation when we feel something of what they feel. We use our God-given imagination and we seek to put ourselves in their shoes. It can really help to enable us to understand how the situation might be affecting and afflicting them. When we try to get down on their level emotionally, we can be better able to minister to them. Many of you may be familiar with the account during 9/11 of those two Port Authority officers who were crushed under the rubble from the World Trade Center when it collapsed. Now they had remained there under the rubble for a few days, and they were eventually rescued. Now, the way they were discovered was by means of a Marine who had been talking on top of the rubble. And he heard one of the officers under the rubble making a loud noise, and this led to the Marine eventually discovering the location of one of the officers. So there the Marine stood on top of all that rubble, and he looked down and heard the desperate cries of the officers. And so there you had these poor officers under the rubble, malnourished, dehydrated, severely hurt, nearly completely incapacitated. And there was no way they were going to get out of there by themselves. So how exactly were they rescued? Did the rescue team just stand up there, you know, on top of the rubble and just yell down to them and say, hey, you know, come on up here, you know, be a man, be strong, stop that complaint. No, did they toss down a self-help book and a rescue manual and bandages, and they just toss down a rope for them to grab onto and that they might climb up? No. See, the rescue workers realized that these officers were so badly hurt and incapacitated that none of those things by themselves would be much help. See, what they needed was for someone to get down on their level. They needed someone to descend down to where they were to help free them from the debris that had crushed them. And that's what happened. One of the rescue workers was willing to climb down to where those officers were to help them. He's willing to put the time and energy into this rescue effort and risking getting hurt and even seriously hurt, even killed, to try and rescue these men. Note that once the rescue worker ended up making that dangerous descent and he was physically at the side of one of the officers, he had a better understanding of the situation. He had gained more knowledge of how badly the officers were hurt and trapped. And because of that increase in knowledge, he was more able to figure out the best way to extricate them and rescue the officers. And thankfully, after a long ordeal, the rescue worker was able to free that officer from the debris and get him to the surface. Now, this account is meant to illustrate something of the nature and power of sympathy when we are trying to comfort someone who is suffering. And those who have been crushed under the debris of some trial or affliction. See, we're not to bark exhortations at them and tell them to grow up or be a man and give them simplistic cliches, tell them to look at the bright side. What we are to do is to weep with them, to sympathize with them. And just as that rescue worker, in the analogy that I gave, got down on the level of those officers that he wanted to rescue, so must we seek to get down on the emotional level of the person we are trying to rescue and comfort. When we lower ourselves down to their level emotionally and begin to feel something of what that person is feeling, you can gain knowledge about their hurt and their situation, understanding their struggles more. And this can help not only to ease their suffering, but to potentially help us to better minister to them and potentially speak words of encouragement to them. I'd like to say, when it comes to comforting someone in pain, before words or advice come out of our mouths, tears should first come out of our eyes. To give one last analogy in regard to the power of sympathy and weeping with others who are suffering, consider a sailboat at sea during a storm, and the captain of the boat is trying to get to shore and to safety. But what will help him get the boat to the shore are winds. So it is that when it comes to a person who is at sea and in a storm of suffering, in a sense, experiencing afflictions or loss, and they're trying to get to the shore of healing, what they need are the winds of compassion from loved ones, blowing into the sail of their life. People who are willing to hear, affirm, and feel their pain and help them navigate through the stormy sea and to arrive safely at the shore of healing. So may the Holy Spirit help us all to be those winds of healing in a world of so much hurt. Thank you.